Well, that's one of your own pieces, Patrick. Penguin Parade. Which came first, music or the music of the spheres?
Well, I've been pottering about with music for a long time now. Let me stress it, Richard. I mean, you know a great deal about music. I know absolutely nothing. I'm a complete musical fake, and I've never had a lesson in my life. I've got one thing that is no credit to me at all. I've got a good ear, and I know that. And that's as far as it goes. The Penguin Parade was a xylophone solo I wrote some years ago now, and that's on the one record I got out, and people tend to think I can't play anything else. Actually, I can.
Which of your many talents and interests emerged first in your young life?
I don't have any talents at all, but, I think I was trying to play the piano even before I could talk, and that's a long time ago now. But I got interested in astronomy at the age of six, and I picked up a book belonging to my mother, who was a little interested, more than most people, I suppose, but not enough to do anything serious about it, but enough to have some books. And I picked up one of these when I was 6 years old. It wasn't actually a boy's book, but my reading was all right, and I got hooked on that one.
But your mother wasn't an astronomer. She was a singer, wasn't she?
She was trained as a professional singer. In fact, before the First World War, she went to Italy and trained there under Sabatini and Clerici, and she was so good that she was actually offered a lead in Italian Grand Opera before she'd finished her training, but she never actually did it because this was 1914. The war broke out, she came back. During the war she married my father, who was an army officer, and she never actually did any professional singing at all, and very sadly I never heard her sing properly. I wish I had.
But did she encourage your music?
Oh, definitely, yes. Mind you, I'm told that when I was a boy, and that's a long time ago now, I had a very nice boy's voice, and I'm told this was true. Unfortunately, when I was either 12 or 13, I forget which it was, my voice didn't break, it shattered. And the result is that now, if I sing, I'm dead on the note. I have got perfect pitch. I do it properly. I produce it properly. I've got plenty of volume. You hear every word I say. And the result is unmitigated disaster. Somebody once told me, quite accurately, that I have a voice like a corncrake with croup.
Well, perhaps you're right in saying that you haven't got a natural talent as a singer. You deny that you've any talents. Of course, that's absurd, because you have a great many. Composing, of course, is something which I couldn't even begin to do. When did you start composing, Patrick?
The very first thing I ever composed was a waltz at the age of 11. And in fact, on the one record that I got out, that was due some time ago, most of the compositions on that have been done, well, within the last 15, 20 years. But there's one march there that I actually wrote when I was 12, and I defy anyone to pick that out from the rest.
Which one is it? Are you going to tell us or
it's
not?
It's called King Neptune.
Right. Kind of music that you listened to when you were young, what was that? Was it largely marches and waltzes and that kind of thing?
Yes, I'm what's called a tunesmith. I mean, I like tunes. I know nothing about classical music. There are some classical composers I'm very fond of, Grieg, Chopin, Tchaikovsky and so on, but they're all the tuneful people. And I'm afraid that when it comes to what I call really classical music, the Bachs and even the Beethovens, I'm not really all that keen.
Did you listen to a great many other xylophone players when you were learning to play that particular instrument?
Well, I had an old trumpet gramophone. I had one or two records of Teddy Brown, the great xylophonist, and Rudy Starita, and I think I've still got those. I never heard him in person, unfortunately. I wish I had. After all, he was the great master of the xylophone, wasn't he?
Like so many other skills, it looks easy, doesn't it? You just stand and it all seems to happen quite simply. But it must be terribly difficult, I would think, well, the placing of these hammers.
If I can play to an acceptable standard, it must be fairly easy. It all depends. I mean, there's some rather nasty key work occasionally here and there. There's a very famous solo called On the Track. And that's written by Simpson, one of the great classic xylophone solos. I was comparing notes the other day with Denny Elvin, who's, I suppose, about the best xylophonist in the country now. And there's a very nasty cross in the middle of On the Track, and we were trying to work out how to do it.
Presumably, you're constantly altering the distance between the hammers. You hold two in each hand, don't you?
Not always. In fact, most of the classic xylophone solos have only one in each hand. On the Track has two in place, and I've just written a xylophone solo that has two. But you don't very often use more than two in each hand, and then, of course, it is a question of altering them around. But I don't think I've ever played in public a solo that involved more than three hammers. I'm not good enough.
Has music always been part of your life, right through from the beginning? I mean, or have there been gaps when you haven't had time for it?
No, it always has been part of my life. And I say I couldn't live without a piano, I don't think, because my drawing room at home now has got one grand piano, two xylophones and a glockenspiel in it. But I have never taken it in any way seriously, if you know what I mean. It's just fun to me.
Do you turn to it when you get tired of doing your astronomy? How does your musical day, as it were, work out?
Oh, it's my great relaxation. I mean, whatever I'm doing, if I feel less interest when to drop whatever I'm doing, go and sit down at the piano or tempt them on the xylophone for a bit, I do so. And there certainly can't be any days when I'm not actually out and I don't have a bit of time on the piano or the xylophone or both.
When did you first start thinking about what your career was going to be, Patrick?
I think I knew from the word go there was only one thing I could ever do, and that was to write. And of course I am a writer, and I think that I never really intended to be anything else. I had no intention whatever of becoming a professional astronomer. For one thing, it's not my line. Secondly, if you're going to be a professional astronomer, you've got to be a natural, gifted mathematician. And I am not, and I know it perfectly well. So professional astronomy was never in my sights. Professional music certainly wasn't. I know quite well that I'm nothing like good enough. So I was going to take my original degree in geology. And I would have taken that as a degree, but I would have certainly written whatever I'd done. In point of fact, of course, as I came up to university age, there was a gentleman named Hitler around, and that was the end of my university. But that was my intention.
Patrick, this relationship between science and music, I suppose, is a pretty close one, isn't it, over the years? There have been a good many scientists who've taken to music as a companion interest.
Well, that's perfectly true. After all, Sir William Herschel, who was arguably the greatest observer of all time, he was, in fact, a professional musician. He was an organist. Organist at the Octagon Chapel in Bath in the 1770s, making his own telescopes. And then, of course, when he discovered the planet Uranus in 1781, he was able to change round and make music his hobby and astronomy his profession. But he was essentially a musician. And many other great astronomers have been musicians also. And Hannes Alfvén, the great Swedish astronomer, he's a composer.
Of course, there was a very ancient philosophical idea about the music of the spheres, wasn't there?
Yes.
As if music was thought of as an absolutely essential component of the whole construction of the universe.
It was indeed regarded as quite genuine right up to the time of Kepler. And I suppose it still lingers on. Remember Joseph Strauss, Johann's brother, and I think just as great a composer, who wrote that lovely waltz, The Music of the Spheres.
Another great scientist who was deeply interested in music, wasn't he?
He was indeed. He was an expert violinist. May I tell you one lovely story? Many, many years ago, when I was a young cadet learning how to fly at the very start of the war, I went down to a conference in New York on my leave, and Einstein was there, and I was invited to a little reception afterwards. Einstein was there, not very many of us. And someone said, "Will you give us a violin solo?" And he said, "I play the Swan. There's no accompanist." Well, there was a piano there, and I just happened to know it. So I had actually accompanied Einstein, and I wish I'd had a tape, but of course there were no tapes in those days.
It's a very great shame there wasn't a recording of that. Was it good?
He was magnificent. I don't believe there is any recording of Einstein playing the violin. There was one lovely story about him, and I think it was with Kreisler he was playing sometime after the war, and they were playing a duet, and Einstein went wrong. And Kreisler made the classic remark, "See, trouble with you, Albert, is you cannot count."
I think that's wonderful. Is there a relationship between the process of composing and your other intellectual work, your astronomical work, for example?
I wouldn't think so at all, because I mean, I know nothing about musical theory whatsoever. I say I know a tune when I hear it, and because I've got an ear, I can sit down and play it, and I taught myself how to read and write. But about the musical theory, I know nothing.
You write it down?
Oh, yes, I can write it down.
Paper.
Yeah. But I know nothing about the theory of it at all. I am told that my various key changes and things are right, but I don't know why.
People perhaps might expect you to write space-type music.
Yes, when people know that I've pottered about composing, they say, "Well, do you write Star Wars kind of music, very modern stuff?" Not a bit of it. Modern music and I just do not agree at all.
What about orchestration? Is that something you do for yourself?
I have done orchestration, but not for a long time now. And the things that are on the record I've brought are not actually my orchestrations. I would have to do a bit more of that, I think.
And what about opera? Because you've ventured into that more than once, haven't you?
Well, I've written the musical scores for a couple of comic operas that have been produced by the amateurs, and I believe the professionals are interested in one of them now. Both ancient mythology. One was Perseus and one was Theseus. And they have been put on. It was great fun. Of course, you know the story of Theseus and the Minotaur.
Yes.
Well, you probably got it all wrong, because unbeknown to you, the Minotaur was really a very pleasant little creature which likes biscuits. And the entire thing is a put-up job between King Aegeus, the black villain of the entire opera, and the King Minos is a great tax-raising fiddle.
So,
and it can get rather fraught when, at one stage, the tribute from the Athenians for the Minotaur is due, and a blazing comet is seen over the Athenian sky. Actually, it's King Minos arriving in Crete in his hot air balloon with the news for Theseus that things are going disastrously wrong at his end of the operation.
So, rewriting mythology is obviously another occupation of yours.
Mythology would be an interest of mine, actually, yes.
Did you ever appear in your own operas?
In each occasion, yes. On the first occasion in Perseus, I played the second priest. I had one line, "It merely laid an egg." And then the second one, I was a member of the Greek chorus, who had one long Greek song, which was in fact the Greek alphabet set to music.
And did you cast yourself in these roles?
Oh, certainly, yes.
What about collaborators when you're writing opera?
I've only done two. In the case of the first one, I did all the libretto myself. And a very old friend of mine named John Oldham, who unfortunately has been dead many years now, he did some of the words of the songs, I did the rest. In the second one, Theseus, I had the collaboration of Roger Pouch, who was once in Welsh National Opera.
And was that an easy collaboration?
Oh, yes, very much so.
I mean, were you one of these composers who said to your librettist, "Now, I want so many lines to fit to such and such a tune"? Or what came first?
The other way around. He gave me the words and I fitted the music to it.
That was really the way Gilbert and Sullivan worked, wasn't it, I think?
Yes, it was, wasn't it? Gilbert did the libretto first and then Sullivan wrote the music to it. But I'm afraid I can hardly be compared with Sullivan. I wish I could, believe me. If I had one real ambition in this world before I leave it, I would like to leave the world one or two really decent waltzes, but I'm not good enough for that and I know it.
But you're still composing?
Oh, yes, certainly.
How is your time occupied, Patrick? Constantly, I would think. I can't imagine that you sleep for very many hours a night, do you?
Don't need a tremendous lot of sleep, I don't think. After all, I'm still an observational astronomer, and I've got my little observatory at home, and I'm very often out there. And this year, it so happens I've done quite a lot of travelling. For example, I've just come back from northern Chile. I've been up at the observatory there, the European Southern Observatory, where they've got one of the most advanced telescope in the world now, the NTT, or New Technology Telescope. And earlier on this year, we did a Sky at Night program from there about the observatory, and the European Southern Observatory liked it and asked me to do their film for them. So I looked at the BBC and we've been doing that.
What particular things are absorbing you at the present time in the astronomical area?
I am still, essentially, an observer of the moon. Now, I know that sounds old-fashioned. After all, we've been to the moon, we've got samples back, we know a great deal more about the moon now than we did only a few years ago, at least before the Apollo astronauts got there. And I spent 30 years in mapping the moon in pre-Apollo times. But there's still a great deal that we don't know. For example, there are traces of activity on the moon. I don't mean man-made activity, but gases escaping from under the lunar crust, and I'm doing that kind of observation now. There are others as well, but I'm still essentially a lunar observer.
Do your musical tastes extend as far as the planets of Holst?
Yes, I like Holst's planets. I rather wish I'd met Holst. I gather this was his one really popular work, and I don't think he liked being a popular composer at all, but it's very stirring, I think. My favourite of all the Holst pieces, I think, is Uranus. I like that one.
That kind of music, of course, gives a certain character to each of the planets, doesn't it?
Well, it does, but don't forget that the planets in Holst's view was really not an astronomical suite at all. It was an astrological suite. And people still confuse astrology with astronomy, and I always say that astrology, the superstition of the stars, proves one scientific fact. There's one born every minute.
Has it never had any appeal for you?
No, definitely not.
What about Gilbert and Sullivan? I believe that was one of your interests, wasn't it?
It still is, because long before I was born, my mother's eldest brother, my uncle Reg, he was a barrister by profession, but around about the 1890s, he threw up the law, went on the stage, went into Doyley Carts, and became their London lead. And I think it was Mrs. Doyley Cart who said he was the best shadbolt in the yeoman there ever had been. Well, of course, he'd retired long before I came on the scene, but I did see him playing shadbolt as an amateur when he must have been in his late 70s or early 80s, and he did look a sight, and I've never seen a shadbolt as good as that.
Have you yourself appeared in Gilbert and Sullivan?
I have, but don't forget, I've got a voice like a rusty saw.
Yes,
there are very few parts I can play. The only part I played, I think, with any real success, as an amateur, purely more than that, was King Garma in Princess Ida, and of course he wants a voice like a rusty saw, which is what I've got. I've always enjoyed tunes. I say I like waltzes, marches, etc. And there, obviously, Gilbert and Sullivan is all tune. And there's some wonderful marches and waltzes in G&S. And, of course, there are the overtures, too. And overtures, I think, are tremendous fun. Some of the overtures of G&S are well known. I suppose the best of them all, I suppose, really, is the Yeoman of the Guard, one that Sullivan carefully put together himself. And others are more or less cobbled together. And Princess Ida, my favourite opera, hasn't got a genuine overture at all. But I suppose the two that are least heard are two that I like very much. One is Utopia Limited, the last but one opera, a mild success. And then the very last of all the G&S operas, the one, the only one that was a failure. And that was The Grand Duke. And having seen it not so long ago, put on by a very good group down in Brighton, I realise it's not a patch on most of the other G&S operas, that I concede. On the other hand, it has got some good music in it, and it has, I think, got a very good overture, which is so seldom heard.
Overture to the Grand Duke. I'm afraid we haven't got time for all of it, Patrick. When you were a boy, was there a lot of music making at home? Did your mother sing privately, and did you have people round and have?
No, she'd really more or less given up, I'm afraid, before I came along. And of course, I had an unfortunate boyhood through no one's fault, because I was ill so much at the time, couldn't be helped. So really, I was more or less a loner through no wish of my own.
What I was trying to get at was that, thinking about the sort of amateur music making tradition that there used to be in the old days, do you think now that it's just as strong as it was? That, you know, there are lots of good amateur musicians around, and
I'm sure there are some very good amateur musicians around, and I'm sure that those who are around are probably just as good or even better than those who were around 50, 60 years ago. But there aren't so many of them. And that was brought home to me a little while ago when there was some kind of ado, I forget what it was, anyhow, people were dancing and there was a record player there, and the record player broke down. There was a piano, and I was the only one at about 60 people who had volunteered to sit down and play for dancing.
Apart from partnering Einstein on one notable occasion, have you had other musical partners? I mean, people that you enjoy making music with?
Well, I had a great friend the other day. I was on the Record Breakers, and Roy Castle was introducing him, because Roy, as you know, is a brilliant musician. He can play anything. And he finished up by playing The Two Imps together as a xylophone duet. That's great fun.
Well, you brought us back to The Sky at Night. And, of course, we started our programme with the signature tune for that marvellous series. How did you come across that particular tune, the Sibelius tune?
When we started The Sky at Night, and that was in April 1957, obviously we had to have theme music, and I discussed this with Paul Johnstone, the producer, who's now dead, very sadly, and I more or less narrowed it down in my mind to one of three. Either the second movement of Sibelius's Corelia Suite, or Grieg's Homage March, or the one we actually chose in the end, At the Castle Gate from Pelias and Melisande. But I thought that Scandinavian music would go down well with the Sky at Night series, and people do seem to like it.
Well, there is, of course, that wonderful feeling about a kind of expanding universe, about the whole thing, isn't
there? There is indeed. I remember once, though, we were up in the north of England doing a programme about the transit of Venus, in the days when everything was black and white and everything was live. And 10 minutes before the programme was due to go out, horrors, the record hadn't been brought. What to do? We looked around for a piano. There wasn't one. We were doing it from a doll museum, of all places. It had an astronomical connotation, that's the matter now. And there was no piano there. There was an ancient harpsichord that I think hadn't been played since about the time of Henry VIII. I had never played a harpsichord. I had never played At the Castle Gate. Nevertheless, I played myself in and out. I hope people recognised it.
With that Sibelius music. Gracious me, on a harpsichord, it must have sounded very, very extraordinary.
I'm sure
it did. There was another tune that you used at one stage for a signature tune for that programme, Patrick. And we ought to have that before we finish.
Only once have we ever used anything except At the Castle Gate. And that was in our last programme about Halley's Comet, which you remember was around some years ago now. And we did quite a number of programmes about that. In the very last one, we thought, well, we'll have a variation. So instead of using At the Castle Gates to fade out, we faded out with the Band of the Royal Transport Corps playing The March, Halley's Comet, that I had actually written myself.
Patrick, thank you very much indeed for comparing notes with me. And we'll just have a little of that march to finish off.